Hello everyone, welcome to the Geo Ecologist. I am Dr. Krishnanand and you have been watching my videos on geography and several related topics of environment and also research methodology. In this session, we are going to learn about a very basic thing related to geography, that is human geography, its foundations, its basic principles, and what are the key components in human geography. Earlier in previous lectures, you may have learnt about various phenomena and various events related to physical geography. So now we are going to talk more on human geography, and today's lecture is more about the introduction to human geography. What is its nature? What is the scope of human geography? And also where it is applied. So before we go ahead, don't forget to subscribe to our channel and also do share the videos with others as well. So now, let's understand what is this human geography. Now remember, the basic definition of geography is the study of various places, people and environment in the simplest way and their interactions. Now what is this human part of geography? That is what we are going to analyze and understand here. So the first thing that we need to remember here is that this geography is created by human beings. Right? That's why it is human geography. It's not physical geography, natural geography, or environmental geography. It's purely human-centric, anthropocentric geography. That's the most important point or catch here. So what do you seek to describe in human geography? Basically, the variations, the shapes, the patterns, the situations, the associations, all these things related to human-created spaces and places. So what kind of places do we create? And what is the basic principle behind the creation of these places? This is what is the basic facet of human geography. So if you observe here, this particular region here has all the physical geography, glacial and periglacial landforms that we have studied in physical geography. But what do you observe? This well-lit portion, human settlement here, this is basically what? A carving niche, including that physical component and impressing cultural component onto that physical component. So what is human being doing? Human being is basically creating its own sense of place through its own cultures, through technologies, through behavior on that given physical space. That's why it is human geography. So human geography, if you observe these definitions here in the list, human geography is the synthetic study. Now here is something which is synthesized, which is not there but created, right? So synthetic study of relationship between human societies and earth surface according to Ratzel. Remember, we have learned about Ratzel's concept in German geographers. If you have not studied, go to the playlist on evolution of geographical thought and there you can learn about various schools of thought in which you have German school of thought, French school of thought, British school of thought, American school, Indian school. There you can observe how people have defined geography and conceptualized various concepts of geography that we today study. Right? So this is one of the definitions. So here synthesis has been emphasized. That's the point. Then if you look into Churchill Semple's definition, human geography is the study of the changing relationship. Now this is what is a dynamic relationship that keeps changing from one point on the earth to the other point. So between the unresting man and unstable earth. Now here two components have been clearly defined, that man, which is now human basically, it should be gender neutral word. So human centric approach towards geography, that how human beings look into the physical space, how they carve out that niche. That's important here. Then dynamism is the key part in the relationship here. Then the next and the most important definition that changed the outlook of the world towards geography, that is human-centered geography, just about 100 years back, about in 1916. Paul Vidal de la Blache, remember, French geographer, the pioneer of possibilistic geographical school of thought. He actually changed the way people looked into geography, and human-centered geography starts from here in the prime way of looking into space. So that was where conception resulting from a more synthetic knowledge of the physical laws governing our earth and of the relationships between living beings and their habitation. This is where concept of genre divi and also the concept of milieu, the niche in the environment that human beings create, all these concepts we have discussed in the French School of Geographical Thought. That is where you see the emergence of human-centered geography just about 100 years back. But remember, these concepts are not just 100 years old. Human geography as a concept, as a thought, evolved right from the ancient. And if you have not watched the videos in Evolution of Geographical Thought, please do go there and see how evolution of geographical thought happened from ancient till today. There you will find the linkages that from ancient till today, how these conceptualizations took place, from percept to concept to theory to paradigms, how human geography evolved. So for that, you must watch the videos on evolution of geographical thought. And now, what is the important point here? That how can we define its nature and scope? What is the simplest method? So for that, what you can do here is learn these five key concerns. If you know these five key concerns, you know what is the basic nature of human geography. So what are these basic concerns? Location, place, interactions between people and their environment, movement, remember the migration of people from one place to the other, and also the concept of region. Now, these are the five building blocks of human geography and its association to various kinds of spaces, various shapes, various patterns that we create on these spaces. So, only five elements will give you how human geographers perceive and conceive the given space, how human geography is constructed, right? So, let's elaborate each point in detail and understand what are these things related to human geography in terms of location, in terms of place, in terms of interactions, in terms of movement, and also in terms of region. So, first point if you observe here is the location point. Now, remember how our human activities distributed across the face of the earth is what it means in terms of location on the earth, right? So, how and where it is located, why it is located there, these are the basic questions that we ask in terms of human settlements, right? So, human geographers believe that there is an order to the uneven ways. Now, remember, it's a very interesting combination of order even in disorderness. So, even you know that uneven ways are there of human beings across the world, but still there is an order that can be discussed and described. That is what the core component of human geography in terms of locational analysis is, in which human beings have inhabited the planet. For this example, this is one of the beautiful examples that you can see here. A simple glance at the satellite image of the Earth at night. Look at this Mediterranean region here, right? The Balkan Peninsula, the Roman area, right? The entire area that you see here across Mediterranean. Now, remember this area. Right, in the ancient, how we have studied the civilizations across Mediterranean and how Greeks and Romans conceptualized geography. So, in today's world, if you observe this, what do you observe? Through these lit portions on your screen, if you can observe, what you observe? This is a pattern. This is a shape that is coming out on the physical earth just because of human emergence and settlements located in particular places. So, what do you observe? This is a geography within a geography. So, human geography is constructed and carved out of the physical space that is there, right? So, some areas are densely populated, human activity is concentrated in some areas while dispersed in some areas, and there is a pattern that is developed. You can see some clusters here, some elongations here. So, various kinds of shape, size, pattern, situation, associations. These are the core building blocks of concepts in human geography in terms of locational analysis. So, the second point here, what you can see is human geographers pinpoint places by referring to their absolute location, for example, their latitude and longitude, while at the same time also, we do what? We do this relative locational thing. So, what is this relative locational analysis? For example, whether they are near or far to some particular place, like for example, if human settlement is situated close to the sea or is it inland? That is what the concept of continentality we have studied, right? So, continentality also determines the land use pattern. Because if it is close to the sea, it is a coastal area, you have a different land use pattern by human beings. It creates a different shape and size, and also the structure which is there on the physical level is different. So, there is a different interaction as well. right? So what you observe, there are certain forces called the unification forces of centripetal forces in terms of human geography, that is, which can drive human beings together. They create clusters. If you observe this map, for example, there are several clusters which are related to the urbanization here. What is this urbanization? Purely a human-centered concept, isn't it? We create urban places. So what you observe in the map, there are certain clusters which are there, and then there are certain areas which are completely devoid of those clusters. These are almost having dominance of centrifugal forces which divide the settlement into different zones or different dispersal areas, right? So we have centripetal forces of unification and centrifugal forces of division of just the patterns that you see on the screen right now. So what you see, the distribution of human activities through these clusters, and this activity is basically nothing but urbanization activities, the developmental activities in modern times that we say, right? So this is purely human geography map on a physical geography of the earth. That's what is interesting here in human geography. So the second thing that is more important here is the place making in geography, the concept of places. Now, what is the difference between a space and place? We have learned in the last lecture on geographical thought, right? So there what we observe, places are not, they become. It's just like the concept of resources. So what is this place? Place is an attribute created by human being, by anthropogenic influence. So places are made, we make places. So if we can make places, we can also unmake places. Remember, if you go to some place, you have an attachment with that for a long time, you actually carve your own environment in that particular place. So it belongs to you. You create a belongingness to that place. But if you leave that place and go there and live somewhere else for another 20 years, 30 years, and then if you come back, you'll only have memories of that attachment, but not that real attachment. So places are also made as well as unmade at the same time. So that is the dynamicity. But spaces are there itself. They don't change in human time, isn't it? Places also, or spaces also change, but they change in geological time as we have studied in continental drift and plate tectonics. For human beings, latitude and longitude doesn't change in human lifetime as such. So what does change? The changes are the attributes that we give to those places. So place making is important in particular locations. So human geographers are interested in finding out what the locations are actually like to live or work or visit. This is our concern. Where do we stay? Where do we live? Where do we work? Isn't it? Everyday life. So how have human beings converted this or the patch of the earth into that particular home? How we have done it through civilizations, through river valley civilizations, haven't we? Now we are doing urban places. We are creating our own niche everywhere we go. That's what is place making. So place making is not just independent of anything, but basically part of human culture. And human culture has several attributes: population, economy, government, race, religion, ethnicity, class, gender, language, and you can keep creating the list. These are the attributes that make a particular place. Right? So if you have to make a place, you need these human attributes, creations, synthesis, right? That's important here. So that's where the idea of cultural landscape is the root or the key to human geography, right? If you observe this, this is a coastal area, and then you see this cultural landscape, the urban landscape here, isn't it? That's what is basically place making if you observe. Then let's go to the third point, that is human environment interaction. This you can observe yourself in your surroundings. How do you interact with your immediate surroundings, with your environs, right? That's important. So in making Earth as home for human being, it's necessary that we understand these relationships with natural environment. If we don't understand how human beings interact with the environment, you will never understand this fine line of thought that what is that linkage that drives the human action that creates an impression on these spaces. Right? That's why it's very important. So societies exist by metabolizing these resources. This is what is metabolism in the space. What do? We take resources, we create something out of it, we construct something out of it, and then create an impression on the physical space, saying that it is my place. Is it my home? Is it my office? This is my industry. This is a special economic zone for me. So whatever you can give an example is in terms of relationship of human being with the resources, with the nature, natural environment. That's what is important. So human geographers examine how societies use natural resources, for example, soil, water, oil, minerals, everything. Then how in doing so, they often pollute the environment as well. So we have environmental aspects, environmental pollution, climate change impacts, and other aspects also, right? And then the third part is how we behave with natural hazards? How do we create disasters for ourselves by not behaving in sync with nature? So that's where we see, how do we live with earthquakes? How do we live with tsunamis? How do we live with hurricanes, floods, droughts? How do we adapt or evolve or withstand? What is our resilient capacity? Or what is the human resilience that we say? Right? So that's important. So that's where disaster studies also come. That's where core component is human geography. So cultural disasters, economic, political, social, all kinds of disaster. If you see this image, a very common thing in urban flooding in India and world these days, isn't it? This is part of human environment interaction. We have clogged all the drains, so the water is not going away. Right? That is failure of human planning, isn't it? So that's where you say interaction with human beings is important to understand in terms of nature and human, right? That's where the third important component of human geography is. Then you see the movement part of human geography. When you see movement part, what do you observe? How and why are these places connected with one another? Remember, place A and place B have these connections, and people travel from A to B and B to A. Right? Isn't it? So this is what we're talking about, movement. So societies are increasingly becoming interconnected with one another. What does it mean? It means that it makes sense to study these places only in relation to the wider networks. So we must understand human networks. From where do we go to a particular place? What is the situation at place of origin? What is the situation at place of destination? All the migration theories, right? All the important points that we study in demographic transitions that we say. Movement of people from one place to the other, rural-urban migration, urban-to-urban migration, and several others, isn't it? So we see these interconnections between the places, right? And also, very important human attributes, the concept of power, the concept of hierarchy in the society, isn't it? That we always come to terms with, the power relationship, hierarchical relationships, the different orders that we create in the society, high-class residential, middle-class residential, isn't it? So that's all the settlement theories for you. Remember Burgess ring model, concentric theory, central place theory, for that matter, the multiple nuclei model, the sectoral model of settlements. These were all class conscious societies that created these situations on the earth in particular ways of settlements, isn't it? That's where we see the movement importantly, right? So places interact, a hierarchical network, that's important, often forms in which dominant places or commanding places or controlling nodes are highlighted. They orchestrate your pattern on the surface of the earth or direction of the movement. Remember, for Indian context, if we say, take an example, what is it? Delhi, New Delhi, capital of India, Mumbai, financial capital of India, attracts thousands of people every day. People come to these cities. Why? Because of certain reasons. Because these cities orchestrate that particular feeling that if they go to that city, they'll work out their living of it. Isn't it? That creates a particular pattern of movement of people. That's purely human geography on the physical geography. Right? So that's where movement factor comes into the picture. Then region concept. In details, we'll also have future lectures on regional planning and development. There, we'll study in details the concept of region and various kinds of region. For here, understand, region is a unique space created by human beings on the basis of their attribute. There can be natural regions as well. But in human geography, we talk about those regions which are manufactured by human beings through their cultural attributes, giving it a sense of place which is unique, which is different from the others, isn't it? That's why it is important. So, for human geographers, these places are grouped for a particular characteristic on the basis of functions of uniquenesses, homogeneity principle, right? So, we see formal regions, functional regions, vernacular regions, or we can say imaginary or temporary ad hoc regions, right? So, formal regions are designated by official boundaries like countries, authorities, states, counties, right? All these places. Then you see functional region dominated by the function, specific function of a particular place. For example, major cities are generally having wider functions. Delhi, at the same time, if I take an example, New Delhi is capital of India. It's also kind of power capital as well. It's also crime capital as well. So there are several interpretations of the same New Delhi, isn't it? So what Delhi itself is? Delhi is a given place on a particular latitude and longitude. What makes it a crime capital, or for that matter, a power capital, or for that matter, a place of livelihood for somebody? The same Delhi has different attributes. Somebody thinks of Delhi as his own home. They feel belongingness to the same Delhi, while somebody says it's just a place of work for me. So these are the attributes which human beings give to Delhi. We give our own meanings to those spaces and create these unique spaces, isn't it? So functional regions is based on the functions. Vernacular regions are basically existing in our imaginations. In temporary ways, for planning purposes, we use vernacular regions or ad hoc regions or imaginary regions. So what are these imaginary regions? Like Middle East. If you say Middle East, what comes to your head? Think about it. When you say Asia Minor, what comes to your head? When you say Central Asia, what comes to your head? When you say Western culture, what comes to your head? These are all imaginative places that we have made because of certain human practices, isn't it? So that's where these vernacular regions, imaginary regions, Caucasians, Latin Americans, Scandinavians, Baltic states, Islamic world, Middle East, several connotations that we say, isn't it? That's all dependent upon what attribute we give to those spaces, right? That's where the concept of region is. So these are the five common attributes of human geography that sums up the entire content of human geography, isn't it? So further, if you say, what is the mission of human geography after all? It's basically to describe and explain how and why human beings locate themselves in particular places, their activities, how they are distributed over space, what patterns they create. Also, they create distinctive places which are different from the others, which are unique in nature, generate various kinds of ecological footprints, right? Every place has a different footprint on ecology. They change the ecology in different ways, right? They connect to the places into webs and networks and invent regions at various scales, right? The concept of scale in geography. So that's where you have the entire focus of human geography or anthropocentric geography that we say. Now, if you look here, there are certain approaches and broad features listed here coming from your NCERT human geography that you study. So what you can do, you can either go to the NCERT and study this through periods it has been given, right? From early colonial period to later colonial period in 1930s, after independence in 1970s and 1990s. How these approaches of human geography changed. Earlier, more of exploration and description used to happen. Then regional analysis came to the picture. Areal differentiation dominated. Spatial organization started in 50s and 60s, where quantitative revolution took place in geography. And then emergence of these humanistic behavioral schools of thought, radical school of thought, feminism school of thought, right? And then postmodernism that we say is after 90s almost, when the world has been completely globalized, the rise of global cities. Isn't it? This is what we have studied in the evolution of geographical thought, which is a summary given here in your NCERT as well. So you can study this table from there as well. And another table is here, the fields of human geography defined. So what are the fields and the subfields? Just look here, you can understand it clearly. So in human geography, one part is social geography, where you have behavioral geography as subfield, well-being is another field, geography of leisure or tourism is another field. Then you have cultural geography, gender geography, historical geography, medical geography. All these geographies are coming up as subfields within human-created geographies, isn't it? Then urban geography, definitely, political geography, population geography, settlement geography, economic geography. All these are the fields of major fields of human geography under which we study several subfields created by human beings. And throughout the lectures on human geography, this is what we are going to study. That's what is the important core of human geography. That is where the nature of human geography lies, and also the future of human geography or the scope of human geography is under these subfields itself. Right? So I hope you understood the clarity on what components make human geography and how we can understand the basic question of what is human geography, what is its nature and scope, and also what are the key components, key attributes, and several other facets of human geography in this lecture. So now, when we have discussed in details the various facets of human geography, its nature, scope, application, in the sessions to come, we'll be talking more on various models, theories, laws in human geography, and also several other topics related to human geography. So don't go anywhere, stay tuned, keep learning, keep sharing. My best wishes to all of you.